Hey everybody, I was just thinking about you and I was thinking about how much I miss being able to gather together and fellowship and worship with you. And there's these songs that have continued to encourage me, and I want to sing these songs with you. And I wish we could be in the same room right now, but since we can't, I know that you're watching and I know that you're singing along with me. I pray that you are blessed by these songs in the same way that I'm blessed, and even more. Will you bow your heads with me before we start? Lord God, I just thank you right now in this moment that you would be so awesome and great, that you would bring us together even now, even in the midst of the chaos that is happening in the world, in the midst of the pandemic that has overtaken our cities and in our country and again our world, Lord. We thank you that you would bring us together in this way, that we would still be able to worship you and give you the praise that only you deserve, Lord. Be with us now as we come into this space of worship and of celebrating who you are and of honoring you in this way. Lord, come into our hearts, come into this place. We love you. Amen. Come on, I need you to sing these songs with me. I want you to give God praise alongside me.
Stories of what Afternoon, New Movement family. It's Matthew from the worship team's Avatar here, wishing you a happy Sabbath. And once again, welcome to our weekly online service. Here at New Movement, we want to do life with you. So today, I brought a friend to hang out with us.
Hey everybody, it's Becky. And like Matt said, here at New Movement, we want to do life together. It is so great to be able to fellowship, hang out, and do worship with you every single week. I am so excited to be here. I can't wait to see what God has in store for us today. Hey, Matt, guess what?
What?
I read this verse this week found in Nahum chapter 1, verse 7. I wanted to share it with you. Is that cool?
Go ahead and share it with us.
It says, "The Lord is a strong refuge when trouble comes. He is close to those who trust him." The Lord is a strong refuge when trouble comes. Can you believe it? God provides his strength when we feel like we are at our weakest. He is there for us. He doesn't fail. It says he is close to those who trust him. So when we feel like he is the furthest away, he gets the closest to us. Isn't that awesome? It's pretty cool that God can do that and that God loves us that much. Matt, I just started a small group, and these are the kinds of things I want us to learn. These are the kinds of things I want us to be thinking about and how God is working. My small group is for ages 13 to 18. If you're interested, I need you to get connected. Matt, can you tell us how we can do that?
Yeah, all you have to do is download the New Movement app to get in the flow and get connected. Join one of our small groups. I guarantee you'll find one for you. You can give financially, and you can give your time and talents by joining a team.
Like he said, get on the app, join a small group, get on a team. We want to do life with you. Will you bow your heads with me as we pray before we get into our worship? Lord God, we thank you so much for being here with us, for doing life with us, Lord, and showing us who you are, revealing to us that you are our strength, you are our keeper, you bring us comfort. Lord, be with us here today as we come into this place and worship you, Lord. Fill our hearts, transform our minds to be who you called us to be, Lord. We love you, and we thank you so much. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
City Heroes, it's Teacher Carol. Welcome. I'm so glad you've joined us today. We have something pretty amazing just for you. I hope you're ready for all the excitement that we're going to have. Are you enjoying these episodes so far? I know I am. I hope you are too. But before we get started, would you bow your heads with me so that we can pray? Dear Jesus, thank you so much for this day. We thank you for our families. We thank you for protecting us. We thank you, Lord, for all you do for us. And we pray that we will have a good Sabbath day today and that we will have fun. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, heroes, are you ready to get started?
Oh, hi, I'm Bruno. And I'm going to be showing you this word wheel. It says perseverance on it. So it says keep trying. Do your very, very, I'll show you keep trying. sit there. Do your very best. Wait. Yeah, do your very best. Do your very best. Never give up. And believe in yourself. Well, that's all right. That's all that's on here. I'll see you later. Bye.
Hi, Hope City Heroes. It's teacher Missy. And guess what? I learned something new. I learned how to play a new instrument. Can you guess what it is? Do you think it's the violin? Nope. Oh, what about the drums? No. Did you guess a harp? Nope. It's a trumpet. Do you want to hear me play? Okay, let's go. Wait a minute. That doesn't sound right. Does this look like a trumpet? I must have lost my trumpet. Where did I put it? Found it. Now that's more like it. Let's try that again. What do you think? Pretty cool? I would love to see what you've been learning. Have your parents record you and send it to team@newmovement.church. And you could be featured in one of our next videos. Are you ready for our challenge time? See you soon, heroes. Bye.
Hey, Hope City Heroes, it's Teacher D, and it's time for our hero. Wait, no, it's not. But it is challenge time. Are you ready? For this challenge, you're going to need an outline of your foot, right and left, and an outline of your hand, right and left. You can choose to either print it out or draw it out yourself. Either way will work fine. You're also gonna need some tape because you're gonna be taping it down to the floor. All right, are you ready?
All right, heroes, as you can see, I have lined up all my printouts. I have 7 of the left foot, 6 of the right foot, 4 of the right hand, and 4 of the left hand. Now make sure you leave some space in between because you're gonna be jumping and putting the hand and your foot according to the printout on the floor. If you put the wrong foot or the wrong hand on the wrong printout, then you have to start all over. Now, it's gonna be super fun if you do this with your family. I have my nephew Johnny and my daughter Sodi to help me out with this. Are you ready?
All right, are you ready, Johnny?
Yep.
Go.
Oh man, that was so much fun. It was kind of hard. How did you guys do? Did you think it was pretty easy or did you think it was hard? What did you guys think about it?
It was really hard for me.
Man, I cannot wait to see your guys' videos. Until next time, bye!
Hi, Hope City Heroes. It's Teacher Maya, sharing our hero highlight. Today, I want to talk about how important it is to share. I'm going to tell you a story about how one kid felt so happy and so appreciated when I chose to share. So, I was leaving my class to go to lunch, and I was with my friends. We were laughing, we were having fun. We were talking about what we did today. Then, as I was eating my lunch with my friends, I look over and I see that my friend Chris is not having a good day. I walked over there and said, "Hey, you look sad, what's wrong?" You know what he told me? He said, "I forgot my lunch today and I'm really hungry." Then I said, "Oh, I'm so sorry, that sounds so sad." Then I thought, man, what would I want someone to do if I was hungry and I forgot my lunch? Then I had a great idea. I remember my mom packed something extra for me in my lunchbox. So I opened it and I found the orange that I had and I said, "Well, Chris, I know that you're hungry, but would you like my orange?" He looked so excited. He was so happy and thankful that I decided to share with him. But that's not the end of the story. Someone across from the other table saw me share and he wanted to share. He grabbed his extra milk box and he walked over to Chris and he said, "Well, here's my lunchbox. I hope that you're not hungry for today." And that's not it.
Other kids were sharing their chips and their crackers and their cookies. Even my friend split her sandwich with him. That day, I realized it made me feel happy that Chris was happy that I shared with him. Even though it could have just been me, he felt so thankful and loved and special, and his day was a lot better. There's a story in the Bible that's a little bit similar to the story I had. One day, Jesus was preaching about the kingdom of God and healing people that were sick, and there was more than 5,000 people there. Now, it was getting a little late, and the disciples came up to him, and he said, "We should send these people home. It's getting late, and they need to get home, go to their homes and to their families to find food. There's no food around here." Jesus thought, because the disciples didn't know what to do, there was a boy about maybe your age who came up to Jesus and said, "I only have 5 loaves of bread and 2 pieces of fish, but I will share what I have." Jesus was so thankful for what the boy did. He went and he prayed over the food, and Jesus made a miracle. He made more than 5,000 baskets of food to share for everyone that was there. And there was even 12 left for the disciples to have. See how the boy just decided to do the right thing and share his food with Jesus? Jesus made a miracle and fed more than 5,000 people. And that day, everyone was happy and they weren't hungry anymore. I hope you enjoyed your lesson today and learned how important it is to share and do what God wants us to do. Thank you so much for letting me share the stories with you, and I'm so glad I learned a lesson with you too. Until next time, heroes, bye!
No. I don't think I have that many fingers. Oh, hey, Hope City Heroes! I was just thinking, can you believe Jesus fed that many people? Wow, that's a lot. What did you guys think of Teacher Amaya's lesson on sharing? It feels so nice to know that when we share, it comes from the kindness of our hearts. Not just because we have to share. I also think that when we share, people view us differently, and they know that we're kind people. What have you shared before? Or can you think of a time that you felt so good for sharing? I really hope you guys enjoyed all the fun we had today. And don't forget to think about sharing, because sharing can go a long ways. People will always appreciate it when we share. But until next time, bye heroes!
I want to share one more song with you. You know, God sets us up even at the table, in front of our enemies, in front of those who are not for us. But you know, he sets us up, he puts us in the room just to give himself the glory, just to put his face there and his hope in that situation. Let's sing this. Let's sing this with passion. Let's sing it with love. Let's know that God is surrounding us in our situation. And everything that is, while everything is happening right now.
In the presence of my
This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I in the my weapons are praise and thanksgiving. Yeah, this is how I fight my battles. Oh, and I believe you've overcome, and I will lift my song of praise for all you've done. This is how I fight my battles. We fight in Jesus' name. We have the victory in Jesus. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you, yeah. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded. So good. You surround us with your angels, with your love, with your presence. Lord, cover us here today as we are in this room where you have placed us. We love you. Amen.
Hey, what's up, church family? Welcome to New Movement Online. I'm Pastor Terrence. I get the privilege of pastoring this church with my wife, Melissa, and my family and our staff. Thank you so much for joining us. This afternoon, we pray that you're blessed with everything that happened and everything you saw. And make sure in the comments you let us know if you're watching for the first time and if you are planning on getting in the flow today, starting with him, getting started. Let us know so we can serve you. Hey, it's a little loud, because I'm outside. And guess what? I am at my home church, the Glendale SDA Church, where I grew up, where it all started, and which is just a few blocks from downtown Minneapolis. And I wanted to invite you to this place because this is where it started for me. This is where I grew up and grew into and am growing into who I am becoming. And I started a series called Flip the Script. And Flip the Script is about Jesus taking what you've heard about what he has to say. And I believe God is still speaking in this moment, right now, what we're living in. And I had to come back home, y'all, to the context where this movement started, where this movement of Black Lives Matter has been re-engaged. It didn't start here, but it's been re-engaged with the murder of George Floyd. And so I've come home to be with my family, to think, to pray, and to be reintroduced to what God wants to say to me and where he's leading our church in the future. And so I came back to where it all started. And there's a verse that talks about Jesus, and that it's a simple verse, and it just says that he grew in wisdom and in stature. Did you know that Jesus grew? Did you know that growing takes work? It takes courage. It takes the willingness to be humble. And Jesus just didn't start off as the Jesus we know him to be, that he grew. He allowed people to lead him. He allowed people to instruct him. And a part of flipping the script is this idea that when Jesus was 12, he had a powerful moment in the temple where everyone was amazed by what he knew and the scriptures that he knew. Well, fast forward 20 years later, here is the same Jesus back as a man, but he is radically changing what has been taught. He's completely flipping the script. And I don't really think you can become who God wants you to become until you go back to the beginning. Until you go back and search the places, your growth places, the places that teach you. And I want to introduce you today and invite you into a conversation that I had with one of my best friends. What am I saying? My best friend, like my brother. We grew up together on the steps of this church. And I just, for our message today, wanted to just invite you into a conversation that we had. And I just hope that you're blessed by it. And so listen to this conversation and look, may the Lord speak to you through it.
It's great, man.
You can start real quick. Well, I am out in front of the steps of the Glendale Seventh-day Adventist Church. It is loud. Matter of fact, I'm going to go like this. I'll do it like this. I'll do it like a mic. I'm going to try it again. I'm out in front steps of the Glendale Seventh-day Adventist Church with my best friend. We grew up together, David Brown. Now, y'all haven't had the privilege to meet him in person, but this is literally my best friend, my brother. Grew up together. We're just catching up. We haven't actually talked in a while, but we are catching up. And as I mentioned, we're in a series called Flip the Script. And the whole world is changed in the last couple months. But when you have people in your life that you love, and what's been interesting, David, is this word essential, right? And it's caused me to refocus on what is essential and who is essential and who do you need in your life. You need people that are going to be there for you thick and thin, that know you, know all your bad stories, your bad jokes, know all the secrets about you. And I'm just inviting you to my personal space and pulling from this text. This is a rich, deep passage of scripture that is ongoing. And as I introduced the scripture about how Jesus grew, I just thought we would talk, you would hear me talk to somebody that I'm not only grew up with, but I'm growing up with. And so this is David Brown.
Hello, good people.
Man, so I can't tell you how many times we've sat on this step, probably when we weren't supposed to, during whatever was happening. And we just kind of shared a special moment inside. Bruno was playing drums with David. Now, David, why don't you tell the story about the drums in this church?
Well, the Adventist church a long time ago was very, very uncommon to see live instrumentation in the church, like drums and guitars and things like that. And thanks to my brother here, who's my elder, actually exposed me to playing the drums. We were younger, we used to run the neighborhood, and we were out in the streets and had the opportunity to go into a drum shop and talk with the rocker dude who, showed us some drums. And I think you blessed me with some drumsticks, some red drumsticks. And so anyways, long story short, I got a drum set for Christmas. T lived, six blocks away?
I think it was further.
I think it was
six blocks. Seem like 6 blocks.
It's a short six
blocks. It was a little strange.
But T came over, we jammed out, and then inevitably that transitioned into us eventually playing in the church, which there was a lot of voting going on with the board. That's where we started. We played for AYS programs. We did concerts together. Good times, man.
Yeah. So it's funny because this is a night where we would typically be at the church, and we wouldn't as freely play as we're playing tonight. But where I got my love for music and where I got my love for instruments is actually in your house. Your dad, the great Eugene Brown, had instruments all over the place. And I would just be fascinated with the keyboards. Man, he had stuff that was probably really expensive. When I think about the stuff he had, he had a whole bunch of recording stuff. That must have been expensive.
Yeah. I had hand-me-downs for a long time, man.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's because of the equipment.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah, we didn't have the flashiest stuff. We were flashy, though. We made it work. And, this place has been, a beginning place. You've actually been here. When I left, it wasn't my own choice. In a lot of ways, we probably didn't even talk about it, but it was pretty traumatic. I think for me, felt like I was being ripped, away from my life and the fabric of who I was. And anytime I come back home, I always wonder where would I be? What would I have done if I had stayed? And the fabric of what's woven into us, where we start, I think one of the things I've been talking to church about is valuing what's essential in your life, but also going back to some of those beginning places and going back to places where you've been before, but you show up differently. Like the text I read, Jesus is just leaving the temple, pretty much confounding everybody. And he returns later as a grown man, right? And they knew who he was. They knew this is that kid that, was ripping it in the sanctuary. And now he's an adult. And now he's coming back, flipping it. You heard this, but now I'm saying this. You heard this, but now I'm saying this. When we were talking a little bit about where we grew up on the South End. And we're going to get a chance to go tomorrow. We're going to go see the George Floyd Memorial. You're here. You watched it. George Floyd. Saw it. You're here in the middle of it. What would you say in this place as a man, not as a kid, grew up in the city? What speaks to you, man? Just with, first of all, how good God's been to you, but just what you're feeling like being here in the city.
Loaded question to you. It really is.
My bad, I'll cut it out.
No, it's okay. I'll try to navigate it. One, just heartbroken just over the situation, what we experienced in the day. Countless times being pulled over for being racially profiled as a black man in Minneapolis. I've had friends who have been beaten by the police that I grew up with in South Minneapolis. It's very surreal, as a grown man. I've always wanted to put my family in a position where my kids have a healthy environment to get a good education and things of that nature. So I'm a little removed as far as physically in the suburbs, but then going back and visiting our old stumping grounds and seeing the destruction and all that happened. And it's just heartbreaking, bro. Really, really heartbreaking. What was the other question?
When you think about where we are now as men, and raising boys and raising girls and thinking about what we didn't know we would experience when we were 12, 13, and now having, you know, we have kids in our house that have passed that threshold, but two that are coming up, two boys, two sons. When you think about as a man now and just how, I don't really know how to rephrase it other than just, I'll say it this way. It's amazing that when I come home, right, or when I see you, when I stay here, everything comes back to me like in real time. Yeah. Like there's some things I don't experience or remember unless I'm with you. It's not there until I see you, and then everything floods back in every single moment, like every single weekend, every single Pathfinder thing, every single, like it was preparing us for now, and we had no idea. Like just the idea of growing up as a man through your mistakes and to, like you said, you moved to the suburbs. When you think back, you know, to when we were 12 or when we were 8 here, what speaks to you? Like what jumps out at you? What's something that you, that just, even in this moment, like what reminds you of, like what comes to your mind and your heart?
Just like literal experiences?
Anything. Like what comes up in you when you reflect, you know, back on those years to where you are and where, you know, where God is bringing us.
Gosh, it's like you said, man, when you are in the environment, like when I go back in the South Minneapolis, a lot has changed. But, you know, sitting here reminiscing, like I said, a flood of memories come back growing up and wanting to be a gangster.
I think I got that picture somewhere. You know? Like, we got to tell the gangster story. We got to tell that when you get that. But, I don't know if I told my mom about that yet.
I just feel like, you know, in the context of what's going on now in our environment, I feel like my sons, they see it. They don't feel it like how we felt it growing up with racism. I feel like it was more in front of our face, you know, things of that nature, civil rights movement, things of that nature. Yeah. So it's been interesting trying to help them to understand what's going on and why, because they see it. I don't think they've necessarily experienced it like we did growing up.
Yeah.
Like you said, it's just a flood of memories that come to mind growing up. Even when it happened, just, I could think of many different instances where, like I said, my friends that I grew up with in South Minneapolis,
I think that's why I had to come here. You know, it's a lot. COVID obviously is a lot. Politics, obviously heavy. But when George Floyd was murdered, and I'm making sure I'm being intentional about my language. I was talking to my brother about that. Like, he wasn't killed. He didn't die. Like, he was murdered. Like, it was murder. And I remember feeling like I need to come home. I remember feeling like I need to go. And one of the reasons I wanted to go and come is to listen. Like listen in the spirit and to connect with people that know me and that I know and can remind me of how much racism we grew up with. Right? Like, I can remember a whole bunch of things. I can remember some moments, even in our advent at school, like I remember clearly a lot of the racism that came from that. And to go back and have the courage to revisit what is painful, it's one of those things that has transformed, you know, me as a man, as a person, to really think about how much I have overcome, but who God has put in my life in those moments to share the pain with. You know, so I'm not like, I didn't just share it by myself. I shared it with you. You said you got friends that have been beaten up by police. You got friends. And where we are, I mean, this neighborhood's totally different. I'm shocked to see who I see. I mean, gentrification is clearly run through here. And in a lot of ways, it's sad. In a lot of ways, it's surprising that the church still looks exactly the same. it looks familiar. I feel like that. It looks familiar. But the pain Like I can feel that in you. I can feel it when I got here. And that's one of the reasons why I really, really wanted to come here. Like I really needed to be here. And a lot of times I wish I was, you know, I wish I was here. And just the way the Lord organizes things and how he places us, where he puts us, we end up where we end up. So one thing was, we were talking about, I was getting ready to bring up the Vikings. And so out of the teams that I did save when I left, the Vikings weren't one of them. It's a shame. Now, this is deep. This is deep. We've cried over this. We've had some difficult moments. Other than that, like, the city has changed. Is there anything outside of, like, what is familiar? What could I go to and be like, this is exactly how it was, besides Glendale? And that's kind of not
that's
funny.
That's probably about it for my person, is Glendale. You know, you could probably go over Little Earth. Do you remember Little Earth?
I think so. Where was it?
It's, you know, the Native American.
Oh, yes. We need to go there.
Yeah.
I'm taking the kids there.
Yeah. That's still the same. It still has that same vibe. The park that's across where your Uncle Roy lives at, that area still kind of has the same energy, same vibe, but not exactly. Oh, I'm just trying to think. It's not a whole lot, bro. A lot has changed.
Let me ask you this about people. One thing I noticed, one of the things that I had to get cleansed from, I think we've talked about it, you fought, is a lot of people here, I don't know what it is about the city, but they get stuck. Like, unless you leave and come back, I swear you can get stuck in your mind, in your patterns, in your places.
Yeah.
A lot of what we try to do at our church is help people find freedom and really get unstuck. And the thing that challenges me about Jesus is that he grew. You know, some people think, like, Jesus just showed up as Jesus. Like, he didn't. He actually grew up.
Yeah.
And a lot of people are afraid to grow.
Yeah.
They're afraid to change. They're afraid to do something different. Like,
yeah.
And if you don't do that, you'll never really grow into who you are. What's probably been something frustrating for you, maybe with the people? Well, I might be putting somebody on blast. But maybe with some personalities that we grew up with or some things that have been frustrating, like that they have not made the choice to grow and go forward. I'm opening a can of worms.
These are some loaded questions.
Yeah. Well, you know, I'm asking a lot of questions because I know I need to grow.
Yeah.
I came here knowing I cannot go back the same. There's something I need to hear here. And in a lot of ways, I felt stuck.
Yeah.
I felt stuck. I felt my church is stuck. I felt I'm stuck.
Yeah.
And so that's why I asked that, because you can speak to me, you know, with the rich...
On a personal note, my family, we were in that position. I feel like spiritually, it was spiritual Groundhog's Day. I don't know if you're familiar with that movie.
I remember that movie.
I felt like we were just doing the same thing over and over and over again, and it had impact on my spiritual life, my personal spiritual life, my marriage, my family, and we had to take a break. We literally said, it started out, okay, we're going to take off one Sabbath just to really focus on the family and self-love. And that evolved into 2 weeks, and 3 weeks, and a month. And I'm going to be very transparent. I mean, it turned into a very long time. But I mean, from a personal spiritual perspective, I grew closer to God. My mindset and understanding who God is and how he works completely has changed in the last 2 years, man. Because I had to step away.
Yeah.
And that's my personal story. And I feel like, I don't know how you, what's the word I'm looking for? convert that to a population of people, a church, to get them to grow, you know, spiritually, to move forward, or what that looks like as a church. That's your area of expertise. But like I said, for me, I'm thankful that the Holy Spirit, when he did, I listened and we took a break because we were crashing, bro. Big time.
Mm-hmm.
Big time. The Bible says having a form of godliness. I feel like we were just in this routine. Come in, happy Sabbath. So.
You know, I think that's powerful. I think it's necessary. I think you have to leave church sometimes to find God. I really do. It's unfortunate, but I struggle in my own church, my own ministry. I wish there were times I could have left. Like I felt compelled to stay, but I felt so frustrated. I think that's kind of where the movement we did starting our church started from. Is out of my own personal frustration with the church. And I'm even more frustrated now because COVID has taken away the ability to meet. And it's some people, like, they're the same. Now, that's not, for some things that's frustrating. Other things that's invigorating is the idea that you don't need to come every week to grow, right? That's not where you grow. It's the people. It's the people that you need to grow. And when you don't got the right people in the church, you can't grow. So that makes sense to say this church is not safe enough. It's not even safe enough for God. Like, God's like, I can't even do nothing in here because these people are just taking over everything I want to do.
Yeah.
And I see church in what I see in the community. I see church in wanting to see your family grow.
Yeah.
And I think there's something about this time when we haven't been able to church that has even been better. Because it's allowed me to say, okay, what do I need? And what about church do I need? What I think, when I think back, as we just greeted someone who came in, the things I don't remember the best three sermons I ever heard. Like, I don't remember, but I remember people, right? I remember three or four people.
Yeah.
That's all church really was for me. Like, it was that person who saw me, loved me, gave us a chance, and pushed us forward. But it ain't about the sermons.
It isn't.
I've heard good ones.
I did, and to reaffirm that point, I'm thinking about the Logan family,
mm-hmm.
just my experience and how they touched my life, just
mm-hmm.
Their relationship with them. And I couldn't tell you anything Pastor Logan preached about, but I can tell you about the energy and the relationship that he had with the people, myself. And that's had the most impact on my spiritual, personal, musical life, big time.
What I love about you the most, man, I'm going to wrap this up, but because my church is getting invited into this special place. I know it's loud, and I don't really care, and I appreciate you being willing to do that. What I always love about you is, like, no matter where we are, and no matter what we've done, there is no condemnation. There is no judgment. It's 100% grace, unconditional, radical love between us. Like, there's nothing you can do, right? There's nothing you can do. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Like, to use that text that could separate us. And even though we don't talk as much as we probably should, I can come back and pick up exactly where we left off. And I would just say, man, if you've got people like that, you need to find. If you don't, God has somebody for you like that. Even if you got to start right now, you need that. You need a place like that, a person you can come back to. Because how do we survive this? How do we survive these tragedies, this pain, the disappointment? How do we move forward? Because in a lot of ways, our kids are oblivious. Like, where the racism we experience and the pain we experience is very real to us. They're growing up in the context of this mess, right? And as our kids are in there playing instruments like we did 30 years ago. 30 years ago. I think it's about 30 years ago, man. Well, no, wait. When do you turn 40?
I don't know what you're talking about. 25. We discussed okay. I have no brain.
Okay, okay, yeah, we can discuss that. We'll let that go. David's about 10 years younger than me. Now, they're going to grow up and they're going to need us to champion and a world that they can grow up in, and a God that they can love, and a church that they can grow in, even if it's at home. So I love you, man. You know that. Thank you so much for joining me on this impromptu message. This, look, this is the sermon, like right here. Like, God loves you like this. Like, this is it. It's always a place of unconditional love. Always a place you can call home. Always a place you can come back to. And whether you haven't been watching this online, you've been doing like what he said, just working on your family. And church, even our church, has been a place that has been healing and restorative to you. That's what we're praying for, that when we do open up, or when we do come back to whatever it is we come back to, that we can commit that our church will be that. And unconditional love, that's the way Jesus grew. That's the way we grow. And I pray you're blessed today. I just want to, why don't we pray for you? Can I pray for him? Lord, as we sit on this step, I see us as little boys, and we battled together. We've seen so much together, and just to be together tonight is such a privilege. I want to pray for everyone, Lord, who's watching this today, that they would hear something and see something in what we've shared just in this moment, to just crack open the door into a rich history of love and a rich future. Lord, I pray that for everyone here knows that, would know that God loves them radically and wants them to not never be alone. Thank you for providing people in our lives to love us and to be there for us. And I pray that we will be willing to receive what you have for us, despite if it's hard for us to receive. Lord, we pray for the city of Minneapolis, the place we call home. We pray for what's happening here. And I pray that as we continue to press for the common good, for a future, and press for your second coming, Lord, that our children will inherit an earth that is filled with peace and love and joy. And may we just take up this cause for your glory. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, thanks for watching New Movement Online today. God bless you. Hey, thank you so much for listening into that conversation. Hopefully you can hear it. I know there's drums going on in the church and cars are driving by, but I hope what you heard today was that a part of your Christian journey, your faith walk, and a part of what I want us to learn and grow in as New Movement is to really embrace the people and the places that God provides for us to grow. Growth takes time. Growth is painful, and sometimes we have to return to painful places. Sometimes we have to return to where there's chaos and there's trouble. And what is that chaos and trouble inviting us to? When we run from what's difficult, when we run from what's painful, we are missing an opportunity to grow. And so I just hope that you heard that today. God bless you. And I just want to pray for you before we end. Lord, I just pray that what was heard today, what was felt today, moves someone into the right direction towards you. I pray for those who want to get started and start their life with you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, those are the fireworks. I am in North Minneapolis, and it's getting dark, so I need to get up out of here. But God bless you, and I pray that you are blessed today.
Man, what a great message that was today, man. I was so blessed. Were you blessed?
I was blessed, Becky.
I pray that you are blessed by that message too. I hope that if you made that decision, you would let us know, because right now, everybody online everywhere is celebrating with you. If you made that decision to give your life to Jesus, if you made that decision to get in the flow or get started, we are celebrating you right now.
Like Becky said, if you made that decision today, we'd love to know about it. So download our New Movement app and let us know.
We want to know, because we want to do life with you. We want to do this and journey with you through all of this. Before we end our service, Matt, will you pray for us?
I sure would. Let's bow our heads. Father, thank you for bringing us together today to worship you. It's great that we have this platform to commune and worship with one another. And I hope that you watch over us and bless us all through this week. Amen.
Amen. Hey, don't forget to join us next week right here, New Movement Church online platform. We can't wait to come back and worship with you. We'll see you next week.
We'll see you next time.